So I've got this friend, and some of you might know him. I'll keep his name anonymous, but I've got this friend who is probably the biggest fan. And now you're wondering, like, is it me? Is he talking about me? Of Barney the dinosaur, right? Some of you might know who this is. Okay, there we go. So he is a huge fan of Barney. His favorite color is purple. Anytime you're wearing a shirt that's of a particular character's color from the show, he points it out and he knows, right? He's like, hey, purple for Barney, right? And he loves Barney. He's got so many VHS tapes and DVDs and stuffed animals and coloring books. He is excited and sold out for Barney. He's like, even one of his goals, he's going to go to Universal Studios to go see Barney, see Barney live. It's going to be awesome. Like, he's excited. I'm so excited for my friend. And when they announced a couple months ago that Barney got signed for another season, another contract, right? Like, they're bringing Barney back. That, right, he's been off TV for a while. It's only been in syndication, but they're bringing Barney back. He's been telling everybody. He's probably told some of you multiple times that Barney is coming back. I mean, I've been with him. He'll tell everybody in the grocery store, hey, did you know Barney's coming back 2017? Like, it's going to be awesome. And so I want to point out that maybe you didn't know this about Jesus yet, right? That Jesus, right, he came to the earth. He lived a perfect life. He died on the cross. He rose again 3 days later. He hung out on the earth sharing, right, proving that he was in fact raised, showing up to different people, teaching them. He was eating food. He was like giving them some last instructions. And for 40 days, he shows up to all these people. And then he ascends. But the good news is he's coming back. Jesus is coming back and we can be excited. I don't know when it's going to be. It might not be 2017. It might not be this year. It might be today. It might be, I don't know when. But we should be excited about Jesus coming back. Maybe you didn't even know this was a thing that was going to happen, right? Because like maybe it's been confusing. Like he ascended like almost 2,000 years ago. And like we've just kind of been doing this thing, right? Like the church has been on the mission of God, empowered by the Holy Spirit, right? The word, the gospel's been going forth across, right, all nations. The whole world is being preached to. And you might be like, is this all there was? Like, are we just going to keep doing this? Is every person in every generation going to just have to choose whether or not they're going to follow Jesus and trust in him for forgiveness? And like, is this just going to happen perpetually? And that's actually not the case. There is going to be an end. There is going to be a time where the earth is no longer going to continue like this, where God will no longer allow injustice to continue, right? Where death, the wages of sin that we've experienced, death and sickness and disease will no longer continue, that God's going to recreate the world into the place that it once was, if not better, right? That he will reestablish everything into a better place, a better way, in a place in which we can be with him forever. And Jesus is coming back. So that's just really cool news. Maybe you didn't realize this. And this is news that Jesus had first shared with his disciples the night before he was going to die. Right, you might be familiar with at least the painting The Last Supper when Jesus is eating with his disciples, he's breaking bread with them, he's modeling this communion with them, and he's telling them, he's like, listen, I'm going to be betrayed. I'm going to suffer at the hands of wicked men. I'm going to die. And his friends are discouraged. They've been hanging out with Jesus for about 3.5 years to this point, and Jesus is like, hey, check this out. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Like, I've got some good news for you. In fact, let's check out this verse, John 14. Maybe if you want a Bible to follow along or to keep it, to take home, Joshua Cousy's is right there. He'll just give one to you. Just raise your hand. And John 14, I've got him up on the screen so you can follow along. This is Jesus talking because his disciples are discouraged. They're like hearing that Jesus, their friend, is going to suffer and die the next day. And he says, hey, don't be discouraged. I've got some good news for you. He says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. He says, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. So Jesus shares this hope with him, not that he's just simply going to be back in like 3 days and hang out for 40, right? But that he's going to come back for his followers, to come back for those who trust and believe in him, that he's going to come back for them, right? He lets them know, listen, I'm leaving right now, but this is for a purpose, right? I'm leaving right now. This is going to be sad and devastating for you perhaps, but this is actually for the better. He actually even encourages them later on in this chapter. He says, I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm not going to abandon you. He says before he ascends in I think Mark 16 that, or no, it's the Matthew 28 one it is. But he says, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That as a result of Jesus' ascension and leaving, it allowed the Holy Spirit to be sent. The Holy Spirit is also referred to as the Spirit of Christ. That in the form of the Holy Spirit, indwelling believers, we are now empowered to go out and do the mission of God and to experience the change in our lives that Jesus promised and died for. And so Jesus is with us. We're not abandoned, but you might have noticed Jesus isn't around right now. Like, we didn't like book Jesus to show up next weekend, like to come and speak here, right? He's not physically here. He's in heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father, but he is coming back. He's coming back. And in heaven, I think this is interesting. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. That Jesus is at work, not just probably using his carpentry skills that he learned on earth, but right, creative Jesus, the one who made the universe, has been spending this time preparing a place for us, for those of us who trust him. And Jesus is preparing this place for us, and he says, I love this line, he says, if it were not so, would I have told you I go to prepare a place for you? It's as if Jesus has a hard time imagining what it would be like for him to lie. He's like, I can't even fathom what this would look like. This is so contradictory to what I am. I only speak the words of truth and life. I don't even know what that would look like. How does that work? Right? Like, that doesn't make sense. Like, in the old King James throughout the Gospels, Jesus would say, verily, verily, I say unto you. Or in the more modern translations, truly, truly. That Jesus only speaks the truth. And so when he encourages his disciples who were discouraged at that time, he's not just giving them like empty platitudes. He's not just like, yeah, there will come a day, right? Don't worry, don't fret, like it's gonna be okay. Like, no, he's speaking the truth to them. He says, listen, I'm preparing a place for you. In some of the older translations, it says, in my Father's house are many mansions. That's likely not what it actually says, right? It says, right, there are many dwellings in my Father's house, but I assure you, we will not be disappointed that there won't be mansions for us in heaven if that is in fact the case, right? It's not like, I'm gonna be like, oh man, like, this is it. Oh, Jesus, you spent all this time, like, good effort, Jesus, but, not my style. No, like, you're not gonna be disappointed. And Jesus says, like, I'm preparing this place for you and I'm going to come back for you to take you to myself. That I find this interesting that Jesus isn't simply coming back to reward believers for their obedience to him. All right, he's not simply like preparing heaven for them. He's not gonna like when you show up in heaven be like, hey, here are the keys. The towels are in that closet over there. The kitchen's over there, you got food. I'm never gonna see you again. I hope you like your place. Like, no. Jesus is coming back so that we can be with him. Jesus isn't interested in just having a bunch of people go to like this place of comfort for him to ignore them forever. The purpose of Jesus' return for his church is so that he could be with us forever. Like, that's really cool. I don't know if you knew that, but God is a personal God who wants to know you and love you and be with you forever. That's who God is. He's a personal God. He's not just like, just ambiguous and mysterious and just like ignoring us. Like, he wants to be involved both in our lives eternally and in our lives on this earth right now. Okay, so this is what we see, that Jesus is going to come to take us to himself again. That Jesus is coming back for his church. Okay, and the doctrine, the word that's been used by theologians to describe this event is called the rapture. All right, the taking away, the snatching away. And as a doctrine, like many doctrines of the Bible, you won't find necessarily like one verse in the Bible that communicates everything about it. That the Bible, it takes a series of verses to build up and to understand and to gain clarity on what's going on here. And the rapture is one of those things. Some might even say that the word rapture, it's not in the Bible, and that actually wouldn't be significant one way or another, because there's a lot of doctrines that aren't in the Bible by name, but are fully supported over the full counsel of God's word. Okay, but the rapture is actually mentioned in the Bible. I think it's 1 Thessalonians 14. If you're reading the Latin version, it's got like rapire is some word there that is the word rapture, the great taking away. Okay, so it is there, but regardless. And this is what I think is interesting about the rapture is there's gonna be a lot of views about it. All right, even in our own church family, even like myself, I didn't want to just come up here and just be like, well, I'll just tell you what I heard. Like, I had to kind of like go and dismantle my belief system and like rebuild it up from a biblical basis, because I'm like, I don't want to just simply teach what I've been taught. But among Bible believers, there's a variety of views on this, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. I'm not discouraged by that, like, man, these Christians can't get their act together. Why can't they all just agree? Like, shouldn't it be pretty plain? Because when the Bible speaks of the future, I don't know if you're aware of this, but we don't know the future yet. So we get like little glimpses here and there where Jesus describes something or Paul describes something. And so we might try to like piece it together, but we might end up with a slightly different conclusion on what that looks like until we experience that event. And it doesn't discourage me, because in the Old Testament, when there's prophecy about the coming Messiah, the Jews were confused about that situation, because in some passages it describes this mighty reigning king who was going to come in glory and establish his kingdom on the earth. And then in other passages, like Isaiah 53, it describes the Messiah as this suffering servant to bear the sins of many, that was going to suffer and die. And it was like, wait a minute, how can I reconcile these two things? How can there be this glorious mighty king and this suffering servant? That didn't make sense to them. And now it makes sense to us, because we realized, wait, there were two comings of Christ, right? He came first as the suffering servant to be a servant of all, to seek and save the lost. And he's coming again as this mighty reigning king that's going to establish his kingdom and to make all things right. So it didn't make sense to them then, like we'd be wrestling with these things, but now it makes sense. And so likewise with our future, when we read biblical prophecy, you know, we might not have it all figured out yet, and that's okay. That's okay. So like, just so you're aware, I do land in the camp of pre-tribulation rapture, okay, where there, I don't even know how far, I've got a clock running here. But there, the Bible describes the end times, that there's going to be the 7-year period of tribulation prior to Jesus' second coming and coming in glory and establishing this millennial reign, and all these things happen. You can go read it yourself. Go check it out. There's a lot of smarter people than me that have written about it, and you can check that out. But I believe that Jesus is coming back pre-trib, but there's also other biblically grounded views on that, and you're welcome here regardless. So it's not like, you know, we're going to have a church split over what we believe about when the rapture is going to happen. Okay, so we don't need to do that. The thing that we do agree about is that we should be excited about the rapture and that Jesus is coming back for his church. And so I want to take a look at some of the significant passages about this and just look at what this is going to be like. Because this is a hopeful thing for us as believers to look forward to, that we would not be discouraged. Jesus offered those words about the rapture as comfort to his disciples then, and it is likewise comfort for us now, regardless what we do face in this moment. So I want to take a look at 1 Corinthians 15:50. I'm going to grab a sip of water. I'm talking fast. Here we go. It's going to be okay. I'll cut out things that I won't have time. It's okay. I forgot to set my timer there, but you can just like come and like, you know, give me the hook if I go too long. It'll be fine. All right, 1 Corinthians 15:50. Thank you, guys, in the back. So Paul writing to the church in Corinth, which is a carnal, secular church. They're all confused. They're caught up in sin. They're confused about the expression of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. They've got all sorts of sexual sin going on in their church. They're all confused, but Paul still writes to them and encourages his church about this event. He says, "I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable." So just in case you didn't know, we cannot get to heaven out of our own effort. It's not about me being good enough to get to heaven. My flesh and my blood is incapable of inheriting God's kingdom. And on that basis, he actually goes on. He says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery," something that has not previously been revealed. "We shall not all sleep." Now, the Bible sometimes uses the word sleep to describe death in kind of a softer way, okay? And besides, I mean, death isn't a permanent thing anyway. There is an eternity that we enter into after we die regardless. And Jesus even used sleep to describe death when he was talking about his friend Lazarus that had died. He says, right, Lazarus is sleeping, and his disciples are like, "What's the problem then? Like, he's fine. Like, he's going to wake up. He'll be fine." He's like, "All right, Lazarus is dead, guys. We got to go raise him from the dead," right? So just so you know, that's what Paul means. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on, man, this is like tongue twister, right? When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written. And he quotes from the Bible here, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Almost like mocking at death, because death is the final enemy to be defeated. And he says, verse 56, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. So Paul talks to this church. He says, listen, there will be believers who die on this earth, that Christians will experience the first death, as the Bible might talk about it. Okay, that they will die, and that there will be those who still live when Jesus comes back. And in a moment, in like the twinkling of an eye, notice it didn't even say blink of an eye, it's quicker than that, right? Something like, imagine like the speed of light, how long it would take light to bounce off the back of your eyeball and back out, right? It's quicker than a blink, all right? Quicker than a blink. So it's instantaneous where there's this change that's gonna happen. It's going to happen first for those who were dead in Christ, those who have been believers that have already experienced the death of their physical body. And then it's going to happen for those of us who remain. That might be us. That might be our generation. We don't know when that's going to happen, but it might be us. And one of the cool things he talks about is that this is the moment in which we will receive our imperishable and immortal bodies. That we're actually going to get bodies like Jesus' resurrected body, where we won't get sick, we won't have struggles with sin and lust and all of these different desires that are conflicting with the spirit that God has placed in us, right? That we'll have brand new bodies, and that we'll be reunited with the believers that have died before us. Okay, so that's what it's describing in this moment. Let me take a look at one more passage. These are kind of the three main passages I was looking at. So John 14, 1 Corinthians 15, and 1 Thessalonians 4. So if you put that up on the screen, this is the last kind of big chunk of verses that I want to give you, because the Bible has way cooler things to say than I ever would. So I'd rather you see it for yourself. So let's see. He says, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep. So the church in Thessalonica, they were concerned because they were like, hey, so Jesus is coming back. Is that going to be Tuesday? Like, when is that going to be? What does that look like? Like, do I have to plan on paying my bills at the end of the month? Can I just like splurge? How soon is Jesus coming back? Like, can I plan on this? Do I have to even bother going grocery shopping this week? Or I don't want to fill my fridge up with things I'm not going to eat. Like, Jesus is coming back, right? This is really good. And then the Thessalonians, they're like excited about Jesus coming back. And then they start to get discouraged. They're like, wait a minute, Jesus hasn't come back yet. And some of us believers have died since we were expecting him to come back. What happens to those people? Did they miss the boat? Like, Jesus didn't come back yet and they ended up dying. Like, what happened to them? And so they were a little bit discouraged. And Paul says, I don't want you to be uninformed. That this doctrine, this idea is something that is worth knowing. That God does not want us to be ignorant on this point. Because even though you might think like, well, what is life application of believing in Jesus is coming back for me look like? How do I apply that to my life? What does that look like? And it changes the way we live when we have a future that we hope in. And this is what Paul says. I don't want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. So there's something hopeful right there, is that when a believer dies, we have hope of seeing them again in heaven, right? That it's different. Yeah, we do go through a moment of grief on this earth. There's a season of grieving that is good and right, and that we're supposed to experience that. Right, even Jesus grieved when Lazarus died and he knew he was going to raise him from the dead like 4 days later. Grief is a human thing that God has placed in us. There is a season to mourn. Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn. But we grieve with hope. We don't get to the point where we are despairing, okay? We grieve with hope. Verse 14, for since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord. Notice when Paul was writing, some people claim, well, the apostles just wrote things down, but they didn't think that they were writing scripture. They didn't think that it was the Bible that they were writing. Like Paul's writing this, he says, this is a word from the Lord. Like he full knew that this is the case, that this is like, this isn't just Paul's idea or Paul's words. This is Jesus's words for his church, right? And even the apostles write regarding each other. I think it's 1 Peter 5. At the end of that, he talks about Paul and he says, sometimes Paul writes things that are hard to understand. That might be the case. I don't know if you've read some of Paul's letters. And Peter says, but you know, as with the other scriptures, some people try to twist this and contort this to their own harm. That Peter refers to Paul's writing as scripture. Okay, so I just think that's interesting. Just side note, man, that was bonus, but I'm just losing time here. Here we go. But Jesus could come back any minute, and like, I might not even have to finish this sermon. Jesus could just show up right now, and I'd be like, all right, that's awesome, Jesus, we're done, we're good. I don't care about the snacks in the back. I'm looking forward to being in heaven with you. So here we go. All right, I lost my spot. All right, we declare to you a word from the Lord that we who are alive and who are left until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. So the dead in Christ raise first. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. So Paul was writing words of encouragement to this church because they were wondering what happened to my friend who has died before Jesus came back. He's like, listen, don't worry. Like they're up there first. We're gonna meet them up there when Jesus is coming back in the clouds at the trumpet of God. This whole event's gonna happen. As it said in 1 Corinthians, they're gonna have new bodies. We're gonna have new bodies. It's gonna be awesome. We're gonna be there. I was telling one of my students the other day, I was like, hey, during the rapture, all right, because I teach at a Christian school. I was like, during the rapture, we'll see Jesus and then we'll find each other. We're gonna give each other high fives in the clouds, right? Like, this is gonna be awesome. This is gonna be great. So like, he's like, yeah, Mr. Wuoti, I'll find you. Like, don't worry, I'll find you during the rapture. It'll be good. We'll high five, it'll be great. So he says, therefore encourage one another with these words. This is not supposed to be something that produces fear in us. This is something that should produce hope in us and joy in us. And notice even the way that Paul closed this passage, he said, listen, that we will always be with the Lord. That's what Jesus talked about in John 14, that where he is, we may be also. It's about this relationship. It's about being with Jesus forever. That's what we're excited about. And so Paul writes this and kind of gives this church some clarity about what this event will look like. And so those are kind of the three main passages I wanted to read. And now I just want to like ask some questions and attempt to answer those questions for us, because we might be confused like some of these other churches were confused. So why is Jesus coming for his church? I've already highlighted this a couple times, because he wants to be with his church. He wants to be with us. All right, so that is like paramount. That's the big idea. It's not just some random abstract thing that God is doing. God wants to be with you forever, right? Jesus was willing to come and die on a cross that he could make relationship with you possible, and he's coming again so that we could be with him forever. So that's idea number one. What will it be like? What is the rapture going to be like? And I don't know, people get fascinated with this idea of the rapture. There's been movies made about it, like bam, like someone vanishes and then like just their clothes slump to the floor and like, oh my goodness, like everyone gets excited and then it's like terrifying for those who are left behind and all that, right? What we see in the Bible is that it's gonna happen in the twinkling of an eye. All right, it's gonna happen swift, it's gonna be quick. Like we're not gonna have a time to be like, oh, Jesus is coming. Okay, like I gotta, Lord, forgive me of my sins. Like I gotta get ready in case, you know, Jesus, because I see him coming over. You're like, no, we won't have time to respond. It's bam, he's here and we're gone. Like instantaneous. All right, here's a favorite question. When is Jesus coming back? All right, you guys can get out your calendars. All right, let's write this down. This is gonna be good. We don't know. We do not know. In fact, what we do know is that no one knows. So when there's like those really awkward situations where like churches are like, hey, September 21st, Jesus is coming back, right? Let's not jump on that bandwagon because that's just going to be embarrassing for everybody. We don't know when Jesus is coming back. We don't know. All right? No one knows. The thing we know is that we don't know. That's what we know. Jesus told us that we wouldn't know. In terms of Jesus is coming back, I think every Christian has experienced this, whether, say, like tomorrow you've got a final exam and you're like, oh man, this is going to be terrible. I'm not looking forward to this. That you're like praying like, Jesus, just come back right now. Like, come on. Right? Jesus, like, or if you're like something like difficult is coming up in the next week, you're like, Jesus, just show up so I don't have to deal with this problem. Like, that'd be great. Right? Just come on back, Jesus. Right? I think people have prayed that. I don't know, maybe not you guys. Or likewise, if there's something good in the future that we foresee in our lives, we're like, Jesus, just hold off until I get married so I can have sex. Right? Or Jesus, hold off until I have kids or buy this house or go on this vacation that I already paid for. Like, just hold off because I've got some good plans for my life that I would really like to enjoy before you come back. Right? That maybe, I don't know, Christians, we are funny people when it comes to thinking about this. Right? We pray all sorts of goofy things, but that's okay. But the idea is that we do not know when Jesus is coming back. But what we do know is that he is coming back soon. That he's coming back at any moment, that Jesus could show up by the end of the sermon, by the end of the sentence, right? He can show up anytime he wants, that there's no prerequisite for him showing up. Yeah, Shirley. Yeah, like Jesus has been speaking to people not only through his Bible, but in their prayer life, showing up to tell them, like, I'm coming back soon. I'm coming soon, right? That he wants the church to be prepared. And so there will be a generation of believers where, right, Jesus is going to show up. I think every generation has wanted it to be them. Every generation has had to live as though it was going to be them because he could show up at any time. All right, even Paul in some of his writings, right, he included himself in the we, right? He said, like, we who live at the coming of the Lord, that we will all be changed, that he was including himself. He was living as though Jesus was going to show up during his lifetime, right? That we live with this possibility of the imminent return of Jesus, okay? And what's interesting is that there will be, although there's no prerequisite sign for his return, he could show up anytime, there are things that after his arrival we can see are prophesied about in the Bible. And as we see kind of culture and society and technology approaching things that now make some of those post-Jesus' return possible, right, or foreseeable, like we can start to anticipate, like, hey, some of these things are lining up. Like, this is kind of getting interesting. When, like, my newspaper, no one reads a newspaper anymore. When my Google Chrome starts looking like what the Bible's saying when I'm reading about current events, when I'm starting to see things that, wait a minute, this is interesting, right? Because there's all sorts of prophecy about this time period in the Bible, about the end, and some of it would not have made sense at the time it was written. Because some of it would require certain technology to be in place or certain governments or culture or different things to be in place. And as we see some of these things lining up, it's just like, this is interesting, right? We should start paying attention to this, okay? Not that we can predict when it's going to be happening, but we should start to be like, like I need to start paying attention, right? I need to look up for my redemption draws nigh. And perhaps the most significant event that has happened in some of our lifetimes is in 1948, Israel became a nation. And in the end times prophecy, it talks about Israel existing. And if you go back and read some of the sermons from 100 years ago, right, Christians preaching the Bible were like, I don't know, I guess we'll just have to live by faith that God is somehow going to reestablish this nation. That they're like, Israel is clearly present in the end days, and Israel's not present now, so God's planning on doing something. Right? So the fact that we live in a generation where something like that has happened should make us alert, should make us aware, right? Get us paying attention, like, wow, like some of these things are lining up and it's interesting, okay? I don't think we have to go kooky. I don't think we necessarily have to start like storing a bunch of food in our basements, buying ammunition or whatever, but just be ready, right? The way you get ready for Jesus is getting your heart ready. It's not about like all of this other zombie apocalypse stuff, okay? So the idea is that Jesus could show up at any time. right? Just like since I've been on the fire department, I have like a pager. That thing could go off anytime. I'm just like needed. I need to be ready. Like go, bam, right? I got to get in my gear and just go, right? At any time, Jesus could show up at any time. So we should be ready. We should be ready. So one side note, when can't Jesus come? When can Jesus not come back? All right, I just told you, you could come at any time. But according to this timeline, this biblical prophecy, which you might be like wondering, side note, that's worth addressing. Why are we believing what the Bible says will happen in the future when it hasn't happened yet? Like, is there any good reason for Christians to even believe that? Like, because we're taking this pretty seriously. Like, when the Bible says this is what the future is going to be like, and we're believing it as though it's going to happen. All right, just so you're aware, like, we didn't just randomly pick a book off the shelf and said, like, I'm just going to believe this one, whatever it says. Okay, the reason we believe that is because the Bible has already prophesied events before they happened, and they happened with 100% accuracy. Right? Jesus alone in his first coming fulfilled over 300 prophecies about the Messiah. So the fact that the Bible's got this really good track record, right? It's kind of like if you saw me like rolling a die like over and over and I'm just like getting six, 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 and I'm just like getting it right. After like I do that 1,000 times, you might be like, there's either something wrong with that die or like Brian is just like really talented or something. Like there's something peculiar here. I should pay attention. This is not some just mathematical probabilistic, you know, phenomena that's happening. Something's up, right? So when the Bible's been right so much already, that's why we take the prophecy of the Bible seriously regarding events that have not yet occurred, okay? So regarding this end timeline, when Jesus is not going to come back is after the wrath of God is poured out on the earth during the 7-year period of time, okay? The Bible speaks saying that we as believers are not appointed unto God's wrath. Right? So it's not something like when you might read the book of Revelation or these different passages in the Bible about like this end times, and it's kind of like, this is kind of getting crazy here. Understand that God's wrath, God's justice being shown on the earth in that way is not meant for believers. Right? And I've got on the bonus content on the back of your sheets. You can check that out. Some verses and passages you can check out on that. So it's not something that you have to be fearful of, but something that we can be hopeful of Jesus' return. So now that we've like thinking about this, and maybe this is the first time you've heard some of these ideas, or just, I don't know about you, but every time I think about this and these ideas, I'm like, whoa, like what do I need to do? Like, how do I respond? How do I get ready for this? And so this is the next question I want to answer with a series of brief answers. How do we respond? How do we get ready? All right, the Bible frequently says that we should be alert, we should be awake, we should be sober-minded, right? We should be ready for Jesus' coming back, right? It talks about this imminency that it is like a thief in the night. And Jesus put it this way, saying that if the owner of the house knew when a thief was going to show up, he would just like set an alarm and just like kind of wake up and be like ready with his shotgun. That's not what Jesus actually said, but that's the basis of what, you know, you get the idea. But Jesus is coming like a thief in the night. Not that he's coming to do something immoral or against his character, but his coming is something that is unpredicted. We don't know when it's going to happen, all right? So we are told to be ready, that we would not be taken or caught off guard, right, like a thief in the night. So during this season, we should be working. We should be about the business of God, doing the mission of God. We should be busy doing the things that God's called us to do. Right? This isn't just a time to like hang out and relax, right? In the context of that church in Thessalonica, some of them were just like so sure that Jesus was coming back that week that they just like stopped working. Like, why do I need to plant seeds this spring? I'm not even going to be around to harvest these things. I'm done. Like, I'm just going to hang out and wait for Jesus, right? And so Paul actually corrected that behavior. He said, no, listen, like you should be working, right? You should be living this life. You should be invested in this life because you don't know when Jesus is coming back, right? We want to be prepared if he isn't going to be here next week, and we should live as though he is going to be here next week. So it's kind of like both excitement and like, okay, but I still should plan, right, my life a little bit. And Paul actually corrected the church in Thessalonica because he's like, listen, this is the standard for Christian believers, that if you're so sure Jesus is going to show up and you're going to hang out on your mountain and not work and just wait for Jesus, if your faith is that great, he says, then try and exercise your faith in this way. He says the rule that we establish for believers is if you don't work, you don't eat, right? So we'll see until the guys up on the mountaintop waiting for Jesus get hungry, and they'll come back and be like, I guess I should probably go get a job, and I'll wait for Jesus that way, right? So that's the sort of thing that we should be doing, is we should be working, but not just in terms of planning our lives and providing for our families, which are good and godly things, but we should be about the work that God's called us to. That passage in 1 Corinthians 15, it said this, right? That therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain, right? So this isn't a time for us to just relax and just like, let's wait for Jesus to solve all the world problems, right? This is a time for us to take action and to be doing the things that he's called us to do, okay? Here's another thing. The Bible says that we should continue to gather together, right? So in the context of church family, that we should be gathering together. It says this, and I don't have these ones on the screen for sake of time. Hebrews 10, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day, capital D-A-Y, drawing near. That as we see these things coming, like lining up, we should be like, well, we need to be about getting together as the family of God, that we can be equipped for every good work, that we can be building one another up in love, that we can be doing the things that we're supposed to be doing, right? So don't neglect, right, meeting together. And that, building off of that, we should be encouraging one another. That passage in 1 Thessalonians 4, he said, therefore encourage one another with these words. That not just encouraging one another towards good works and towards loving our neighbors, but we should be encouraging people with just like, hey, Jesus is coming back. Like, this is gonna be awesome, guys. Like, don't despair. Don't only focus on the things that are going on in our temporary lives. Like, let's look towards eternity. Let's live for eternity. Jesus is coming back. Or in 1 Thessalonians 5, this is one I think I did throw on the screen there for you. He says, for God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. So if you die before this happens, you get to live with Jesus. If you live while this happens, you should be living your life both in eternity and on this earth with Jesus in mind. And he says, verse 11, therefore encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. All right, another thing that we should be doing is Peter says this in 2 Peter 3:12. He says, waiting for, looking forward to, and hastening the coming day of God. And I think that's a really interesting thing, that we as believers should be speeding up the rate at which Jesus is going to show up. Like, we can actually, it's weird, I don't understand how it all works, but apparently we have some ability to speed up when Jesus shows up. And I think that's interesting, okay? Peter doesn't explain how we would do that, but elsewhere in the Bible, I think there's some clues. Even in the Our Father, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, right? We pray that Our Father who art in heaven, right? Man, this is embarrassing. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Hey, that's all right. Hey, I'm human, guys. I'm human. Yeah, wow, you helped me out. See, you're encouraging me. I love this, right? Hallowed be thy name. And then check out this, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We want to see God's perfect will accomplished on this earth, that even through our prayer life, that we're hastening the coming of the Lord. And another hint at how we might accomplish that, when Jesus preaching in Matthew 24 regarding some of the signs as to what the end will look like, one of the last ones he gives is he says, and this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So one of the ways we can speed up Jesus' return is by being faithful to preach the good news of salvation through him to the whole world, right? That if we're about the business that he's called us to, the mission that he's given us, the faster we share that good news, the sooner Jesus comes back, right? So that's just some side notes for you to be aware of. Two more I think I've got for you. In 1 John, the Apostle John, he's writing to the church, and he says that, like, we can kind of have like these two different responses to the idea of Jesus is coming back. And I think this is interesting. I think this is kind of somber, this idea. I see some of this in me and my own attitude and behavior. and check this out. 1 John 2, he says, "And now, little children, abide in him," right? Continue in Jesus. Invest your life in Jesus so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming. I think this is interesting that it's possible. I think he's talking about believers here, those who will be saved, those who are saved, but it's possible for us to live lives where we would be ashamed when Jesus shows up, right? Like, it's like Jesus, like, "Oh, you showed up now? Like, I'm kind of embarrassed. Like, I'm in the middle of living my life for myself and not for you," right? And even though Jesus knows everything we think and say and do, regardless of when he shows up, that we can possibly be ashamed when he shows up, being like, "Man, I've been living my life for me," right? My priorities have been out of whack. I've been investing everything I had into maybe my own pursuits and my own pleasures rather than the kingdom that you told me to be about, right? That it's possible to be ashamed at his coming. And the solution to that, because I think all of us kind of feel that way, like, I don't want Jesus to show up when I'm binge watching Netflix and just be like, "Oh man, this doesn't look good. Like, I'm just kind of wasting a bunch of time here." But one of the ways we can solve that problem or that anxiety, if we have it, is to abide in him, just to continue in Jesus, right? Don't be like so focused, like, "Am I doing enough? Am I doing all the right things?" Just fall in love with Jesus, right? That's the whole reason he's coming back for us anyway, so that he can be with us forever. So let's be with him now. And if we're with him now, like, we're not going to be ashamed at his coming. And that's what John says a couple verses later. He says, "Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope purifies himself just as he is pure," right? So one of the things that we are encouraged by is like, hey, I've got this hope of Jesus appearing, and that when he appears, I'm going to be like him. I'm going to get a body that, like, is like him, that isn't going to be always working against me, that I'll have a body that isn't perishing and dying and fading away, but it's one that's going to be eternal. And because I have this hope, I should be about the business of purifying myself, of living as though this is true, of wanting to be like as much like Jesus as I can now, right, in this temporary body, right? That I want to get my life ready. And it's not something that I've just got to figure out for myself. It's not like, well, I guess I just got to, like, whip this together. Here we go. Like, let's just set some resolutions and I can make this happen. Jesus is doing that work in us as well. He's the one who is the one equipping us and preparing us. In Ephesians 5, it talks about that he is preparing for himself a church, a bride, so to speak, who is spotless and holy and without blemish. That Jesus is working in us. It's not just us having to figure it out for ourselves. And so regardless of kind of like where we land on when Jesus is showing up, we don't have to be afraid, right? We don't have to be afraid. This isn't to produce fear in us. This is to produce joy in us. That the Bible talks about, this is our blessed hope. This is our blessed assurance that we get to look forward to this moment. That in Hebrews, as the worship team's coming back up, I'm going to skip a bunch of verses. You can always check online and get the rest of the stuff that you think you might have missed out on. In Hebrews 9, it says, "But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself," right? Jesus showed up once already to put away sin with his own death on the cross. And he says, "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment," right? That you and I will experience death. So I guess there's two imminent things that could happen. We could either die and meet Jesus, or Jesus could come back and we meet Jesus. He says, "So Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin," right? This isn't for him to be able to process that whole forgiveness of sins thing, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. Amen. Right? That we can look with anticipation. We can look forward to Jesus' return. And when Jesus was speaking to John the Apostle, right, on the island of Patmos, when John's writing the book of Revelation, which is a scary book of the Bible if you read it, right? At the very end, the last chapter, Jesus says, "I'm coming soon." And John responds, he says, "Amen, like, so be it, like, let it happen." And he says, "Lord, come quickly." So that can be our prayer. It's not something we have to be afraid of. It's something that we just need to be ready for Jesus' return, right? And like I said, that's not storing up cans of food. It's getting our heart right before God, abiding in him. And so you right now, if this gives you a degree of anxiety, I would encourage you, pursue Jesus, abide in Jesus, get your heart right before Jesus, purify yourself just as he is pure, right? That's not saying like, I've got it all figured out and I'm, right? I'm saying all of us, that's what we're to be doing. We're to be about the business of God and the mission of God, reaching our community, because we don't know how short the time is, all right? He is coming soon. So let's pray, church family. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that you love us, that you are a sending God, that you sent your son to save us. I thank you, Jesus, that you chose to suffer and die on my behalf because you loved me while I was your enemy. I thank you that you care about us to that degree and that you want to be with each of us forever. I thank you that you, Jesus, are a sending God as well, where you send out your church into the world to share this good news, that we can be excited about your coming, that you have not left us as orphans, you have not abandoned us, but you've equipped us and empowered us with your sweet Holy Spirit. And I just ask, Lord, that you would prepare our hearts, help us to just be reminded about your goodness and to live for eternity and to not just be so invested in this life and our own things. So God, I just ask that you would be glorified, not just in these last couple songs as we sing to you, but glorified in our lives and in our hearts as we pursue you to abide with you forever. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.